This evening on The Rock Newman Show, 50 years after the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., equality for black boys and men remains a dream. We'll explore the causes behind the extreme inequities and discuss real solutions that work. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. A new study by the Equality of Opportunity Project shows that black boys, even when growing up alongside upper and middle class white boys, are more likely to end up poor in 99% of America. The DMV and certain New York neighborhoods are the exceptions. We'll break this down and look at solutions with Spencer Overton, president of the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies, Damian Jones, head of school at the Edmund Burke School in Washington, D.C., and Michael Williams, founder of the Minority Scholars Program in Montgomery County, Maryland. Gentlemen, welcome. Thank you so much for joining me here today.
Thank you.
Even when I hear what I said earlier, that in 99% of America, black boys growing up, if they're in an environment and in a neighborhood next to upper and middle class white boys, have a chance of growing up significantly greater chance of growing up poor,
right,
all over this country.
Right.
Let's take a stab at trying to understand why that is. Spencer, let's start with you.
Just quickly, what's important to note is that the same thing does not hold with black girls in that study, right? Okay. So it's not something about black folks being different in terms of cognitive intelligence, et cetera. This phenomenon was distinct among black boys,
yes,
and not girls, which I think is significant,
yes,
for us to appreciate and recognize,
yes,
you know?
You know what, Spencer, you call that a phenomenon, and it certainly, right, it is.
Right.
I think I want to put an exclamation point on it, that it is a crisis.
Right.
That is a crisis because the multitude of issues and problems that come out of that statistic show up every day in extraordinarily negative ways. If I could go to you, the head of the Edmund Burke School, Damian, want to take a stab at why today is 50 years to the day of the assassination of Martin Luther King. And in that opening, I said, equality for boys is very much still a dream. What's the issue? What's the problem?
Well, I mean, I can tell you what I see with the students that I work with. I think that oftentimes they're struggling with these competing narratives where, you know, we live in a country that talks about all the opportunities that are extended to them, and yet, you know, these young black men are faced with, you know, systemic inequities that prohibit them from gaining, you know, a foothold in the schools that, you know, we are responsible for giving shape to. And so what I mean...
Let me interrupt you, because I think what you're saying, I just want to, again, put a stamp on this.
Right.
Their reality is not the reality that is talked about the American dream.
Correct, right? Mm-hmm. And so when you think about these young men who are being told that they can achieve a certain level of excellence and success in one way,
yeah,
but their lived reality, you know, sets them up to have to contend with obstacles that prohibit them from getting there, these young men, you know, are struggling to figure out, you know, how to take these steps forward in order to achieve success. And so I think about my son, right, who is 16 years old, And there are two types of conversations that I have to have with him. There's the conversation that I have with him about how he has to do certain things in order to be a certain way in school. Mm-hmm. And then there's the conversation that I have to have with him about how to realize who he is, you know, as he's trying to grapple with what it means to be an African-American male, you know, and sorting through the different pop icons that he's trying to put on, you know. Yeah. And I think it's important for his development to try these things out.
Yeah.
However, in school and in public places, you know, that could be a challenging experience for him. So he's oftentimes straddling the fence between what it means to be who he is in a school environment, what it means to be who he is as he's contending with becoming himself through different references to pop culture.
Yeah.
And then what it means, you know, to live in a world where, you know, being a certain way could be a death sentence. So it's tough.
Damian, let me stay with you just for a moment, because you say you have a 16-year-old son, and someone looking through an objective lens would say, man, that's a scary proposition. Have you had a conversation with him when you say you talk to him about what it means to be a young black male? Have you had the conversation with him about if he should happen to get pulled over or stopped by police?
Yeah, that conversation is had every day. We actually, before moving to D.C., lived on the south side of Chicago. And so there were constant conversations had about how he needed to interact with law enforcement.
Yeah.
Now, the tricky side of that is, you know, I don't want to pathologize, you know, law enforcement.
Yeah.
Bearing in mind that I have several family members who were Chicago police officers.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, you know, he needs to understand the reality of not knowing how to engage the police and what the result of that could be. You know, we're trying to figure out as parents, my wife and I, how to help him feel more at ease, you know, in moving through this lived experience.
What a thin line. What a tightrope,
it is.
Man.
But the reality is he has to learn how to contend with it, because I don't want him to be so relaxed, you know, that he forgets that, that things can happen.
Mike, Damian has a 16-year-old. You have a toddler.
Yes.
Let's stay in that ballpark for a moment. Are you frightened?
My wife and I talk about this topic quite frequently. So am I frightened? Yes. And I'm not even sure whether I can say I'm hopeful as of yet, but there's a significant amount of fear of what he's going to encounter as he grows up, as he moves from being a cute little toddler to that age of being a 13, 14, 15-year-old where people's perceptions of him then change. Right now, he's loved because he's cute by outsiders, folks who don't even know him.
Yeah, sure. You know, and we cannot underestimate. Let me say it again. We cannot underestimate the impact and the stress that African Americans, particularly, to a perhaps a little lesser degree, other minorities, have to deal with that factor and that level of stress that we're talking about right here, just trying to communicate with our loved ones, being to some extent apprehensive and fearful about what is going to happen to them, because we're faced with brutality, police brutality and murder and killings much too often. We just had a gentleman here, Mike, who came through your program.
Yes, sir.
Let's hear from him, a young man, and then keep this going. Let's take a look. Shane, thanks for joining us here today.
Nice to meet you.
All right. So given that we're talking about programs that attempt to address the inequities in the learning and achievement and success of black boys and the disparities that continue to this day, 50 years after the assassination of Martin Luther King, please tell us about the program that you went through and how it impacted your life.
Okay, well, the Minority Scholars Program is a student-led, student-driven initiative aimed at attacking the achievement gap. Mm-hmm. And we have different focuses that we use to attack the achievement gap, such as like college visits and speaker series. Mm-hmm. And engagement in the community. Mm-hmm. So I first joined was the end of my sophomore year going into my junior year.
Right.
And I mean, it was my first time hearing about the program. Mm-hmm. You know, I might have been a little late on board, but I remember that my mom brought me to a meeting. It was on a Wednesday afternoon. Mm-hmm. And I was sleeping before, so uh-huh. I remember my mom brought me to a meeting and she was like, oh, you're gonna go to this and, you know, let me know what you think.
Right.
And at first, you know, when your parents drag you out to something, you're like, oh, this is gonna be
automatic resistance.
Yeah, you're like, right. Oh, this is gonna be rough. Yeah. But I remember getting there and I was like, within a couple minutes, I was like, man, this is really interesting. And yeah. I remember hearing Mr. Williams talk and I was like, so inspired. And I was like, man, this is really interesting. So I joined mm-hmm. and then I brought it back to my high school, not me myself, but Mr. Williams and a couple others right. helped bring it back to my high school and start a program at my high school mm-hmm. that I ended up becoming the president of my senior year, and it's still active to this day. So it's something else.
Would you say that in real terms, you feel like it changed your life?
For sure, because I mean, even if you look at my report cards before, like, I wasn't failing before yeah. I joined the program, but right. you can just see that I'm peaking more definitely because of the program, and my grades have continued to go up even in my freshman year of college.
And this is something that you would recommend others?
Extremely passionate about it. For last year, I had to get people involved, and I remember talking to some people, and I remember one time I was talking to a fellow teammate of mine for basketball, mm-hmm. and I stopped myself mid-sentence, and I said, you know what, just come to the meeting. You know, yeah. I can tell you, people can tell you anything they want, but when you see it in person, it's completely different.
Yeah.
So I said, you know what, just come to the meeting, and we'll talk, and if you don't want to join after, you have no commitment or anything.
Sure.
I remember him coming to the meeting, he's like, wow, this is something else. It's so interesting.
I really appreciate you being here. Part of what we attempt to do is to change lives in a positive way. And your testimony this morning helps us with that. Thank you so sure. much.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Thank you.
All right. Mr. Williams, mm-hmm. you found this program. Not founded it, but you found it. What was it that you found so compelling that made you know you wanted to bring it back and institute it in the school where you were operating?
Yeah, well, I was one of the co-founders of okay. the program, and we were, I was at Walter Johnson High School in Bethesda, which, you know, as we know, in Montgomery County Public Schools is considered one of the top schools, and Bethesda is one of those more affluent areas. And we were approached by Morehouse College to offer a full scholarship to one of our African-American males who met the minimum requirement of a 3.0. Mm-hmm. And in this top school in a top county of Montgomery County, we had none in 2005.
Zero.
Zero. Mm-hmm. And so it was the opportunity and achievement gap hitting us in the face. Mm-hmm. And my principal called myself and another young lady, Esther Adams, who was another African-American teacher, together to have a conversation. And from it, this program erupted. And I have to say erupted because when we presented it to the students and we polled a number of minority students to talk about why they weren't in these challenging classes, the APs, the honors, it ran the gamut from I didn't want to be the only Black or Latino in the class to mm-hmm. my first day of class, the teacher asked me if I was in the right place. And all of that, we realized that's an issue that we're having structurally mm-hmm. within our school system that we had to address. And the students took the bull by the horns and they ran with it. And it became a student-driven initiative, not that we had it planned out. Mm-hmm. It was something that the students kind of created in and of themselves.
Somewhere within those students who too often are statistics is still that innate desire to improve themselves.
Yes.
Spencer, you've been in the Obama White House. You were in the administration
right.
at some point.
Yeah.
So let's talk for a moment from a policy perspective. Mm-hmm. We see the reality that you say, you know,
right.
it's not so much girls, it's boys.
Right. And I don't mean to discount the challenges that Black women have.
I understand.
Right?
I understand.
It's just that I think sometimes, especially in traditional progressive circles, it's kind of like race discrimination and gender discrimination, and progressives just assume, well, Black women are at the bottom of the totem pole and everybody else is above, and they don't recognize the unique challenges that you know, confront black males in society and that they need to be addressed, right?
Sure, sure. So from a policy point of view,
right,
what voice would you give, what would you say to those who are promulgating policy,
right,
that are some of the strategies that can help these communities address these issues?
Right. Well, one big issue is what we see right here, this notion of, you know, local leadership in particular schools and in particular districts addressing the challenge and addressing the issue, right? And there are a number of things we talk about. Some of these are academic, but there's also a social component. So really looking at the local level. You know, MBK, My Brother's Keeper, which was launched during the Obama administration, came up with some ideas, but largely a lot of what they did was provide a platform for cities and schools and particular local areas to kind of elevate this issue mm-hmm. and address it. So as opposed to all the solutions kind of being a top-down mm-hmm. scenario, mm-hmm. this notion of giving a platform and giving voice to people who are on the local level, mm-hmm. which is what they did then, and they continue to do it now. You know, the Obama Foundation, mm-hmm. My Brother's Keeper Alliance is now a part of the Obama Foundation, and they're continuing to have competitions to hold up local solutions here in terms of addressing these challenges. Another, you know, there's also an Executives Alliance mm-hmm. for Men and Boys of Color, which is a group of foundations that are focused on this issue and are funding different solutions in terms of this problem across the country. They have been very active as well. That was another plus of MBK. You remember, we had a hard time in terms of getting a lot through Congress.
Yeah.
And this notion of being a platform yeah. and holding up issues that were of concern to us mm-hmm. and not just going through Congress, working through yeah. cities, et cetera, was key. Right?
Makes me think that you might have known about some of the footage we have, because we have something, we actually have footage from President Obama mm-hmm. talking about My Brother's Keeper. Let's take a look.
All of you know the statistics and the stories of young people who had the intelligence, the potential to do amazing things, but somehow slipped through the cracks. And I've said this before, I see myself in these young people. I grew up without a father. There were times where I made poor choices, times where I was adrift. The only difference between me and a lot of other young men is that I grew up in a more forgiving environment. I had people who encouraged me and gave me a second chance. And that's why Michelle and I have dedicated so much of our time to creating opportunities for young people. We know this is not just an urban problem. It's not just a people of color problem. This is a national challenge, because if we're going to stay ahead as a nation, we're going to need the talent of every single American. And even more than that, this is about who we are as a country, what our values are, whether we're going to continue to be a place where if you work hard, you can succeed, or whether we continue to see stagnation and diminishing mobility.
Spencer, you see yourself in that speech?
Oh, definitely. You know, Rock, I grew up, when I was 7, my parents moved from inner city Detroit to a suburb of Detroit called Southfield, right? Mm-hmm. And by the time I was in high school, you know, when I was finishing high school, mm-hmm. I had a 1.8 GPA. I started off like in accelerated classes,
yeah.
right? IB program, other things,
yeah.
and then just, there were no other black males in yeah. those classes. It was just a big time in terms of identity. Who
yeah.
are you?
Yeah.
Who
I mean,
are you
so,
with?
So, man,
right?
you went from honors classes to a 1.8
yeah, 1.
grade
8
point average.
Yeah.
And I want to ask you, mm-hmm. spell out for us, as you remember it,
right.
what contributed to your downturn?
Right. I think, what is black masculinity here? I think is difficult. You know, there are all these factors in terms of teachers making certain assumptions, right, that you are not there. I think there are peers in terms of girls being attracted, you know, almost looking at the achieving student as, you know, somehow emasculated or not black or inauthentic here, right? And so there are a lot of those factors. Some of it is just natural that everyone's faces, but some of it is unique in terms of black males, right? So I did not graduate. I failed English. I didn't get stuff in. I just skipped class. It was just all not serious to me. And then I went to Hampton, right? Yeah. And I was trying to not go back home and deliver pizzas and live with my parents, right? And I got 4.0 first semester, and then things just went well. Graduated with highest honors from Hampton, and then I graduated with honors from Harvard, which is where I met the president. We were there at the same time, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so things really turned around. And one of the big things for me in terms of him being there at Harvard Law School was I was nervous going back into an integrated environment because I'd had so much failure, right? And there was this black environment where I'd had so much success in terms of Hampton.
Yeah.
But this notion that the president of the Harvard Law Review
Yeah.
was a black male who was also committed. It wasn't like he was a black male trying to distance himself from blackness, right? He was very committed at the time, and that certainly was a confidence boost for me in terms of going into that environment and achievement and blackness is not black achievement was not an oxymoron, right? You know, that was something that was very possible at Harvard Law School and, you know, did well there.
Yeah, fantastic. Damian, so you're at Edmund Burke. Edmund Burke was founded, in the 70s?
1968.
And a very progressive agenda founded by those who, you know, it's often described as a couple of hippies that founded Edmund Burke. And by and large, you know, for generations, there was a sense of a kind of a loosey-goosey, laissez-faire, educational, non-structure, but kind of getting it done.
Right.
And part of the reputation that you gained seems to have been creating more structure. Tell us about this journey of your coming into Burke and trying to turn it, trying to maximize what it was there for.
Right. You know, I have to start with why the school was founded. Mm-hmm. You know, the founders were really taken up in social change. And so when they gave shape to the school, they were interested in capitalizing on all the young folks who were coming to the nation's capital in order to seek social change the world over.
Yeah.
And so when you think about a school that begins that way and where it is today, it's always been on this trajectory of realizing the importance of having folks from all walks of life included in the process of giving shape to the educational experience. I always, you know, kind of push back on the notion that the school was loose because the idea that creating an institution where you're going to provide agency to the multitude of people who have different religious backgrounds, who come from different socioeconomic classes, who represent different sexual orientations, whose racial and ethnic makeups, you know, are international in scope, you got to give them space to sit at the table, which means you got to back up a little bit in terms of creating an opportunity for all those people to be engaged. And that's what brought me to the school. You know, being from Pittsburgh in the 1970s, you know, where I grew up in a city that was very segregated, you know, and then moving to Chicago, of all places, to a city that was even more segregated than the city that I was born in, and then coming to a city like D.C., where you see at a school like Burke, the diversity of folks who are able to contribute to decision making, the opportunity that teachers take to pause to consider whether or not certain perspectives and points of view are being welcomed into the space, and more importantly, the agency that we give the students to speak up and to be heard. And so you and I were talking earlier about a student who is at the school who is at the third generation to come through Burke.
The first one.
Yes.
The first third generation.
The first third generation, yes.
Ms. Worthy.
Yes.
I'm going to say that.
Yes,
I'm going to take the license
yes, sir.
To say that. Ms. Worthy.
And when when Kim talks about her experience at Burke, she talks about the fact that she would leave school to protest outside of the South African embassy, or she would leave school to join marches on the mall. We still do that because it's really important for us to ensure that students can connect what they're learning in the classroom to being civically engaged in processes and movements that are occurring right out in the backyard. And so I've come to an institution that's had a history of this, and my job as a caretaker mm-hmm. is to ensure that we can continue to put students front and center mm-hmm. and help them to activate all that learning and to turn it into engagement, you know, in the cultural spaces that they occupy, but mm-hmm. also in the political spaces that they want to take charge of.
Okay, and let's keep this, and let's keep the focus here. On the issue of the black male. So
yes.
if you could share in your time here and in your other educational pursuits, what you have found the challenges of the black male to be.
You know,
unique challenges, I'm going to say.
Yeah, I think that, and it really resonates with what the others have said. If black men don't have windows that they can look through, if they don't have folks who can provide them with some sense, other black men who can provide them with some sense of what success looks like, mm-hmm. then their ability to gain access to these upper level courses, their ability to assert themselves in the spaces where students seek leadership, mm-hmm. their ability to exercise agency and control over space is really limited because they may not know how to activate themselves in that way, not unless you see someone do it. And yeah. so for me growing up as a child, you know, what was really important in my life was that I had a mother mm-hmm. and I had a father, but my mother more so was very committed to ensuring that people were put in front of me. Other black men were put in front of me, mm-hmm. you know, who were very well educated, you yeah. know, and who were exercising power in ways that would demonstrate to the first, you know, a person in my family to go to college, you know, that these things could be done. So my parents were not college educated. Mm-hmm. They never, you know, felt that they could get that far. Mm-hmm. But I had a grandfather who was very well read, you know, uh-huh. who always talked about college being an opportunity to change the trajectory of the family, but he didn't know how to make that work. And uh-huh. so my mother was smart enough to build on that
yeah.
and to find black folks, black men in particular, right. who knew how to navigate that space. So I think that when you don't have that in schools, when you don't have that operating at the local level where kids are able to say, yes, I know, you know, certain folks who can help me to sort out how I can see myself differently, then I think that their opportunities are limited. So I look at the role that I play at a place like Burke,
yes.
right? We're in Greater Washington where there are many independent schools, mm-hmm. But the reality is there are a few black men who are heading them. And mm-hmm. so I'm always emphasizing to the African-American males that I come into contact with that it's very rare to have an opportunity where you can sit with someone like me. And mm-hmm. so we have to figure out how to create more pathways to leadership for you. Mm-hmm. And it really starts with being able to look through the experiences that I've had as well as all the other black men who teach at the school. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of uniquely positioned in that way where mm-hmm. you have a lot of African-American boys at the school who, if they can't sit with me because they find that I may be too buttoned up or, you know, not coming at them the right way, uh-huh. there are other men in the building who uh-huh. can offer them different ways to consider how to get from where they are to where they might like to be. Mm-hmm. And I think that's another important point. Growing up for me, you know, in the neighborhood that I lived in, the way that we kind of looked at black masculinity kind of fit with the mold that you were mentioning, Spencer, in that there's a certain bravado, you
yeah.
know, there's a certain way that you have
oh, sure.
to manage your space.
Yeah.
But the reality is black folks are not monolithic,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So if that way of managing my space doesn't fit with the narrative I want to give shape to, where do I go from there? Mm-hmm. How do I take another step forward?
And so a young kid can feel so terribly lost.
Yes. And so you got to give them a variety of ways to take that next step. I mean, when you think about what the white male counterpart has in the way of a multitude of different personalities,
sure.
perspectives,
sure.
narratives to try on,
sure.
and then you think about what we limit black boys to, mm-hmm. it's like, yeah, one way to be,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And that way of being sometimes does not comport with what the school expects, mm-hmm. what the outside world expects.
Sure.
But it also may not comport with what this boy wants.
Yes.
So I
yes.
think that the goal, as I see it for me as a head of school, is to create a variety of ways within which these young men can see themselves.
Yeah.
And then to kind of hold up the fact that they can be any one of these things, because in adolescence, there's this fluidity of identity. You know, you can be this mm-hmm. thing one day, and this thing the next,
yeah.
and this thing this next week, because
yeah.
you're trying to figure it
That's
out
right.
as opposed to being locked into one way of being.
Yeah. So let me ask. Mm-hmm. What he's giving voice to is the absolute necessity of reaching these young men where they are. Talk to me about, again, more about your program and what it is that you're doing to reach them?
Well, I think kind of just as Damian mentioned, is that we're providing that space and that opportunity. We're providing the students, the young men, the black males, the understanding that you can be cool and smart at the same time. Mm-hmm. And you can do it how you want to do and you don't have to be limited. But I think I would also add that there's another piece, not just saying that there's a lot of these opportunities. It is deliberately tackling the racial misperceptions mm-hmm. that are out there. And if mm-hmm. we don't deliberately tackle them, mm-hmm. then we're still going to be stuck in similar situations.
Because one should certainly argue those deliberate misconceptions are deliberately promulgated.
Yes, right. Yeah. Yes. I personally feel that, and I'm a teacher, love teaching, yeah. but I personally feel that teachers are just, we're this close to those cops uh-huh. yeah. in that how we perceive or misperceive children, especially black males, yeah. the fear that many teachers have, yeah. the suggestion subtly to themselves or to ourselves, I'll say, that somehow this child can't succeed yeah. is what forces black males into positions that they may think are the only options for them. Yeah. And then that just gets reshaped and returned around even in the heads of young men. So yeah. I think we deliberately have to get young black males to understand that this isn't your only destiny, this isn't your only option. You can be cool, you can be smart, you can do all that you want to be, you can talk how you want to talk as long as you're doing the business in the classroom, because that's going to provide the opportunities for you later.
You know, I am, this is heavy. This is a heavy subject. Yeah. I really would have to think a lot about trying to answer a question that I have from within, because as I'm hearing you talk about, you know, the value of providing them with good example and getting them away from the stereotype that has been thrown at them so repeatedly from media, culture, institutions, of hearing this voice of Mrs. Moldonia, mm-hmm. who was a teacher of mine in the ninth grade, who very forcefully told me that I was never going to be anything. Mm. Mm-hmm. And I always connect.
And you still remember her name.
Oh, Miss Maldonia. Oh, yes, I do. Yes, yes, yes. I remember that. I also remember the alcohol on her breath. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, one of the great, maybe greatest, professional nights of my life was standing in a boxing ring and having represented the guy and brought him through the maze of the crazy boxing world, and his hand being raised as the heavyweight champion of the world. Mm-hmm. And then that was a Saturday night, that was a Friday. So it wasn't Monday till we were able to cash the check. And this, you know, check that was pretty substantial. And literally sitting there with the president of the bank where we cashed the check, Miss Madonia's voice was still there. And so by the grace of God and reading Claude Brown and Man-Child in the Promised Land, yep, yep. And Malcolm X, and becoming a disciple of Muhammad Ali, who defied all conventional wisdom, and coming to an institution like Howard University, mm-hmm. which lifted me, and it lifted me beyond that assessment that she gave. It just makes me so passionate that the three of you are here and we are talking about how to reach those who might not be the beneficiary of sort of all those other forces that I had. You all have to be those forces, man. So, you know, thank you for being here. Spencer, I see you reacting.
Yeah, I mean, those books were just so meaningful to me in terms of an image. And I think another thing in terms of the little bit of stuff I've done, mm-hmm. you know, Bob Marley has that thing of that song, you know, my fear is my only courage, so I've got to push on through, right? Mm-hmm. And so for me, like going to Harvard Law School, mm-hmm. it wasn't about being a lawyer. It was about freedom from the Miss Maldonis of the world and not having them shape who I was going to be. Like liberation from that, some freedom, you know?
Hello. Mike, you were a great student in high school.
No.
Okay.
Absolutely not.
part of what we've come to understand is that you had some influence. You came to Howard University.
I sure did.
And you had those that were advising you that perhaps Howard University wasn't a place for you. Tell us about that.
So I'll take back a little bit is that I was very much a classic underachiever. I tell even some of my students, there were really two things that I cared about in high school, and that was soccer and girls. Those were my passions, you know. And but I definitely had fortune of having a lot of male role models, including my father, who literally told me straight to my face that if you don't pick up those grades, you're not playing soccer. And at first I was thinking, oh, he's just talking about high school soccer. So. Yeah. Right. And then he must have read my mind, and he said, nor club. Mm. And then I started picking my grades up. Mm-hmm. But it really was when I got to Howard.
So he reached you. He reached you at that point.
Yeah.
Of what was really important to you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he knew, and my parents knew that, you know, there was more to what I was putting forth in the classroom.
Yeah.
When I got to Howard, I think it was maximized even further because I came in and I played on the soccer team, so yeah. I was here a couple weeks before most of the other students, yeah. and I'm seeing some sharp brothers.
Yeah.
And sharp brothers who were brilliant and doing it in the classroom yeah. and on the field, and if I may, getting the girls as well.
Yeah.
And so I was like,
yeah.
oh, I've got to do something. So
yeah.
even in my challenging classes of math, mm-hmm. I had two of my teammates who would tutor me every other day just to mm-hmm. make sure. But it was a sense that, oh, this is what I need to do. Mm-hmm. And I also remember on my first English class, perceptions that I had perhaps even been indoctrinated in me. Mm-hmm. A young man who's now pretty famous, William Jelani Cobb, mm-hmm. he walked into that classroom with the hoodie on
yeah.
and the backpack, strolling in a little bit late. And yeah. I know a lot of us were thinking, who does he think he is?
Yeah.
But when he started talking,
yeah,
all of us stopped.
Yeah.
And to this day, he, for me, is two things, not only one of the brilliant, most brilliant people I know, mm-hmm. but also this understanding of you can be who you are and be intelligent mm-hmm. at the same time mm-hmm. without any fear.
Mm-hmm. 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 So the value of saying to these kids who right now are that statistic we talked about, that 99% of the country, they don't fare as well. Part of what we need to be saying to them is you can be authentic.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Be right. Or let's find who you are.
Right.
And hold on to that authenticity.
Yep.
Spencer.
We're not asking you to abandon blackness here. Yeah. We don't want you to
yeah.
abandon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you bring so yeah. many talents to the community that we need you
yeah.
and we need you to develop
yeah.
these
yeah.
talents
yeah.
right for
yeah.
the community. So we don't want you to abandon
uh-huh.
our folks. I guess one question I would have for you two is, where do black parents go to figure out what schools are and what school systems are doing well with black males, right? Like, so many people move places because the test scores are high or whatever, but that doesn't necessarily mean
yeah.
that's the way it is for black males, as
yeah.
you mentioned, in terms of your particular school, right?
Yeah.
So how do you figure out where are the environments that are best for black males, where black males are thriving?
Couldn't have asked a better question myself.
Yeah, I mean, I think you do it in the way it's always been done. You talk to other black parents,
mm-hmm.
and you ask them about how their sons have fared in certain environments, and you ask them about whether or not, when they raise issues and engage in conversations, if they're being heard. Mm-hmm. The reality is, if black people can't come to a school and say that they're dealing with, even if it's perception, you know, certain issues associated with how their kids are able to come into the institution, and people are not pausing to say, let's look at that and understand it, because some of those perceptions can turn into realities that will arrest the development of a student's, you know, trajectory academically, socially, or otherwise. And that's not the kind of institution that you want to subject your child to, because The reality is, I think about the kids that I work with, if they believe that the institution is not open enough to being all the different ways that we say that they ought to be, and they're kids, right? So they're constantly experimenting with identity, they're constantly trying things on, and if they think that just trying something on is going to be met with a punitive response, they're going to shut down. That will certainly cause the parents to express some concern about whether or not their kids can be well-educated enough because they're not being welcomed in whole. And when we talk about authentic, particularly when you're talking about teenagers, that's everything. You know, to be yourself means you should be given the space to try on anything that suits you in the moment. And so it gets back to the conversations that you have when you're sitting around your dinner table, you know, or when you're kind of out to breakfast with, you know, other black folks and you're saying to them, here's what my experience is like, or I heard about certain experiences at other schools. And that's how I think it works. Because the reality is, I think all schools want to ensure that they are inclusive spaces, but not all of them are.
And I think I would agree, and I think there's a, we are not going to find a perfect school anywhere. We're not going to find a school yet where we, where you're not facing some of those issues. So, as you mentioned, if the school is open to hearing the voices of the students and being able to adjust, I think that's key. But I think it's also key that we have to arm our kids, our boys, all of our kids of color with this desire to create change. Because we're in a world where they're gonna face it. And we're gonna send them to schools where they're gonna face it. I grew up in Montgomery County. My mother will tell you that if she wasn't in the system as an assistant principal, all four of her kids, they attempted to put in remedial courses. And I consider myself the dummy of the crew because I've got a sister who runs a, one of the top OBGYN practices in the area, another sister who runs one of the top dental practices in New York.
And those charged with their care. We're trying to put them in remedial courses.
And I decided that I had to push with this Minority Scholars Program because when I came back some 20 years later, the same issues were still occurring right over here in Montgomery County. And I love my county. I love my school system. And what I'm probably most pleased with is that now there is this more discussion and people are, our superintendent is pushing for talks about equity. So for me, it's not that it's not there, it's that, as you mentioned, how we're addressing it. There's a space that's that we're able to talk about, and I actually attribute some of those students for creating that space.
You know, I want to throw something out on the table as to what it is that can be done to make the profession of teaching more appealing to black men with degrees. What can we do? Anybody want to take a stab at that tough one?
I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, I think that what I contend with is whether or not we can offer all teachers in general, but certainly black men with a certain level, a level of education, a competitive salary, you know, whether or not we can offer them access to pathways towards leadership, and then whether or not we can create spaces for them where they feel safe, you know, to speak in ways that are critical and clear. Because when they come into schools, and I'll speak about my own experience, when I came into the first independent school that I worked at, it was very clear that I can that I could only talk and engage in a certain way. You know, I was very much concerned about, you know, the impact of presenting myself in a certain way, you know, on, you know, my professional trajectory. Newly married, you know, just had a child, and so I'm trying to figure out, like, how to, you know, pay the rent, you know, and make a life in a very cost prohibitive city like Chicago. So all those things, you know, are what you contend with. And in this school, there may be like a handful of black men, you know. So, I mean, I think that if you're able to kind of offer those things and then provide really great mentorship and support, because I think that sometimes when you come into a school environment, particularly an independent school, you're not really sure how to navigate, you know, some of the very difficult political context that you are faced with. And what happens is many men will decide not to speak. And so when we connect that to what then our students see, right? So if I am 16 years old, and I'm trying to look at whether or not it's okay to speak up and to be heard, and I see brothers who are not talking at all, you know, because the space is not safe for them, that sends a direct signal to me, particularly when I'm trying to figure out like how to unload this thing that I'm carrying. So I think schools have to, you know, be very committed to ensuring that black men and black teachers, men and women, are safe to give voice to the things that they contend with. And some spaces don't do that.
I mused on Facebook at one point. I call it musing, but it was something that just like, at some point, I just had this feeling. So you got your mama and your daddy, and then the next most, typically, most influential person in your life is a teacher.
Right.
Are your teachers. And if that's the case, teaching is a profession. And it is a profession that good teachers very, very positively and dramatically affect our communities and the world. I think that by about 75%, teachers are dramatically underpaid. Some kind of way, it seems, for our betterment as a society, that we've got to figure out a way to change the dynamic and the paradigm of the very, comparatively speaking, low wages that teachers are paid.
I think that's right, absolutely right. I'm completely with you, especially since they play such an important role. When we talk about what we can do as black folks, certainly there are a lot of municipalities that are largely black that could possibly do something about that, right? I guess another question is, are there other forms of compensation that we can provide within our community in terms of a certain amount of status and elitism in terms of black teachers and respect? So even if someone isn't making a whole lot of money, that it's not just money, it's like we respect you and we hold you up, and you know, it just like as a community kind of a value here. And that's not to say we shouldn't pay them. Certainly we should pay them, but the things that are in our control, certainly this notion of the status of teachers within our community, that is something we can control. This notion of a guild and an elite group of teachers who are kind of focused on our kids as critical to our future as black folks, you know, to me, that's something that's significant.
Let's kind of go to the core of something. I want, again, we're talking about your program, and the this program is something that, as we well see by Shane, who was here with us earlier today, you know, he gives voice to the impact, the your minority scholars program, that the impact, the positive impact that has had on his life. Can you point to illuminate that further? Can you point to examples of seeing a student come through who might have been really struggling or headed in the wrong direction, and how this program helped arrest him, turn him around, and get him pointed in the right direction?
Yeah, we have numerous examples. We're now in 22 high schools in Montgomery County, 10 middle schools, and it's just blossoming. We've been getting calls from different districts to come and talk about how we do it. I could name a number of students, and what's interesting is that some of our best leaders were not the 3.5 students, but these were students who not only got it, but were sharp, but just may not be showing it in the classroom at that particular time. And they, as kind of Shane mentioned, they turned themselves around because they realized that they have a role and a mission within at least their time in high school, and that was to help change and create opportunities for others like them. And so I could reel off a number of names and a number of students who it's changed their lives. And they all come back. We have just had our 7th annual intra-county minority scholars program retreat. We had about 15 alumni who came back to take part and speak on it and be involved. So,
Mike, you mentioned you were at zero black males who had a 3.0 in 2005, right? What's that number like now?
Well, that was at one high school where
it
started.
Right.
So now, and I'm no longer at Walter Johnson High School,
okay,
but up to the time where I left, and I think I left around 2014, every year thereafter, Morehouse had a scholarship or two for one of our students. And mm-hmm. so that was a sharp change from zero to, you know, I think one year they had offered five, all five didn't take it, mm-hmm. but it was a drastic change. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that had to do with the fact that the students felt like they had a place, they had that opportunity right. for agency, and they believed in themselves to create mm-hmm. Some change.
Can I just add one point?
Sure, please do.
You know, when we talk about the kind of growth that students experience and even growth that African-American males experience, I think we have to be careful not to suggest that it's linear, in as much as the growth that they experience sometimes is not realized before they're well beyond the experience that they have in programs like this,
mm-hmm.
or the growth that they experience can also be met with setbacks. And I think that if we lock ourselves too much into this linear way of thinking, mm-hmm. which is, if they're not making progress in demonstrating, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. quantifiable growth, that they're not experiencing any growth at all.
Mm-hmm.
The reality is adolescence is very messy, you know, and kids oftentimes don't know what they're being equipped with until they're beyond an experience, and they're applying those skills differently than they could have when they were first taught them.
Right.
So, you know, I'm raising this because I think that sometimes when we're talking about black males, we talk about progress in this linear way, but the reality is when you look at how their counterparts, you know, are being evaluated in terms of the progress that they demonstrate, we give enough breath to assume that, you know, you might not get it now, but you need to learn it, right?
So that
when you're able to apply it, then you can kind of kick it into gear and get it done. So I think we also need to give black folks, you know, the same latitude.
Mm-hmm.
It's messy, it's unpredictable, you don't know when you're gonna use it, you may never apply it when I teach it to you, but at some point you may come back to it and not get it now, but maybe in 5 years or 10 years. So I think when we talk about progress, I'm much more interested in longitudinal studies, where we're looking at like what it looks like in 10 years as opposed to in the year that the thing is being applied.
Mm-hmm. Let me try to give a great example about that. Our 43rd president, George W. Bush, you know, when you look back at his trajectory and sort of some of the things that he did, you know, the knuckleheaded things that he did, that's a classic example of a certain form of entitlement and just what you're talking about, giving the latitude for there to be growth. I'll flip to like another example. It's obviously arguable, you're from Chicago, you probably would agree with this, but that Michael Jordan is the greatest basketball player that ever lived.
Mm-hmm.
No one would ever say that Michael Jordan was come close to being the greatest coach that ever lived. Oftentimes, if you are terribly gifted, you don't necessarily learn the fundamentals and you don't go through the struggles that allow you to teach those with less talent than what you have.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make you a sharp teacher if you are more blessed with these superior skills. So what we're talking about, and the reason why I bring that up here is because we're talking about trying to reach these kids, trying to reach them where they are, giving them latitude to make their mistakes and to find themselves. And when they do, as opposed to necessarily that person just kind of runs right on through and is doing all the right things, when they go through those kind of struggles and then find themselves, look out, you're getting ready to look at a quite possibly a strong leader.
I would also say that we want to give the latitude, but we also want to make sure that we're there supporting and pushing.
I have
a number of student names, current students of mine, who, and two in particular, two black males who I believe to be two of the sharpest students at John F. Kennedy High School.
Mm-hmm.
And yet they're struggling, and they're struggling with the issue of, for lack of a better word, trying to be cool in their blackness, perhaps some other issues.
Mm-hmm.
But one was put in an ED program, emotionally disturbed, from when he was young. And if it wasn't for one of his basketball coaches who recognized in middle school, like, this kid doesn't belong in it. So it took him a while to be taken out of that program. And so I'm thinking about how lost, all those years lost, and we're trying to catch him up, and he's slowly and struggling. We got another kid who was, I just found out he was two and three grade levels ahead in both reading and math, and yet never was put in one of our magnet programs or one of our excelling programs, and how now, I don't know if it's the anger from it or perhaps other things, but that combined, those things, I think about those lost years, and how do we capture those students who are brilliant.
So critical for the parents to do what they need to do to make sure that they get the proper care. Tony Williams, the former mayor of this city, was thought to be, was told that he was retarded. His family, his mom, and Lord have mercy, his mom was a firebrand who just flat out said, hell no. And here's someone who said that wasn't able to be educated, who went on to become, to do what he did, to get a degree from Harvard, come back here and to lead this city, the nation's capital. Thanks so much for each of you for being here. This is a crisis. With people like you on board, man, I think we can have a chance to impact this crisis. Again, thanks so much for joining us. Thank you. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and may God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.